Joseph Rescigno, talking about my book, Conducting Opera, Where Theater Meets Music. In this particular video, I would like to talk about operas that have different versions. Now, I mention this topic in passing in my book, but the only opera that I go into any depth about as regards versions is Wagner's opera, Der Fliegende Holländer, the Flying Dutchman. There, it's mostly about the two different orchestrations. In this video, I would like to talk about Mozart's Don Giovanni, Verdi's Macbeth, and Puccini's Madame Butterfly. As you can see in the appendix to my book, you can download scores for free at these two sites. I'll repeat the relevant information during this video, and it is printed below. Now, Mozart wrote Don Giovanni for Prague. The opera was a big success in Prague. The only change made was that after the first performance, the epilogue for six people that Mozart wrote was dropped. It was considered excessively long. But the opera was certainly a huge success. He then brought it to Vienna, and some changes were made. First, the tenor was different, and he did not want to sing the aria Il mio tesoro in Act Two, so Mozart wrote the aria Dalla sua pace instead. He also put in a scene for Leporello and Zerlina in the second act, and he restored the epilogue, which was cut after the first performance in Prague, but he wrote a little 10-measure bridge that eliminated almost half of the epilogue in duration. So he basically shortened the epilogue by half. Now, what do we usually hear in performances? We hear everything, with the exception of the scene for Zerlina and Leporello. So we do both the version of Prague with Il mio tesoro and the version of Vienna, which also had, besides Dalla sua pace, the florid aria for Donna Elvira, Mitra di quella ingrata. And it's a rather long evening, but as I say, in virtually every opera house, the duet of Leporello and Zerlina is cut. More and more frequently, the second aria of Leporello in Act Two is cut. It just describes he wants to run away, and that's usually cut by him just running away at the end of the sextet. However, if we do all three arias, that is, Leporello's aria, Il mio tesoro, and Mitra di quella ingrata, we have a very static three arias in a row. Even eliminating Leporello's aria, we still have Il mio tesoro, and followed by Mitra di, which is still quite long and quite static. What do I suggest? I suggest doing basically the Vienna version. That is, singing the aria Dalla sua pace for Ottavio in Act One, cutting Leporello's second act aria and the scene of Leporello and Zerlina in Act Two, which is becoming more and more standard to make that cut, not doing Il mio tesoro of Don Ottavio in Act Two, because that was the Dalla sua pace was done in place of that. And therefore, you only have the sextet, one aria, Mitra di, of Elvira, and then we go into the cemetery, so that the flow of the action is interrupted only by one aria. In addition, I think that the bridge cut that Mozart made for the Vienna production works very well. I've never heard a production that uses it, but it's very effective. And if time is of the essence, eliminating Il Mio Tesoro and making the bridge cut will bring the opera in within the 3 hours. This, of course, assumes that we have a unit set and we're not stopping for scene changes constantly throughout the opera, which is pretty much the expectation of today's audience. Let me just play a little bit of what that bridge cut is like. It starts, I'm going to start 8 bars before the bridge cut. Here it is. Resti dunque quel birbon con Proserpine Pluton, con Proserpine Pluton. And we're back to the music 5 pages later. Now, how can you get this bridge music? If you go to the Mozarteum's digital Mozart edition online, you can get the orchestra score of the Baron-Reiter critical edition for free. You can download it. And the great advantage is the Baron-Reiter has measure numbers throughout the whole opera, and you see exactly where this fits in. Okay, now, what about Verdi's Macbeth? He wrote the opera in the 1840s and made substantial changes in the 1860s. I really think that for the most part, the second version is superior. If for no other reason, it has a magnificent aria for Lady Macbeth that you really have to do, called La Luce Langue in Act Two. The one slight caveat for me is the ending of the second version. Verdi tried to bring the opera closer to the Shakespearean play's ending. And in the play, not only does Lady Macbeth die off stage, but Macbeth dies off stage as well. And the armies come back with Macduff. They go off dueling into the wings, and he announces that Macbeth has been killed. I really prefer the ending of the first version. Macbeth is mortally wounded on stage. He sings a brief aria called Mal per me, and then there is one line of Macduff and one line of the chorus, and the opera ends. So my suggestion is at rehearsal number 35 to go to the end of the first version, the aria Mal per me, and finish the opera with that ending. One other suggestion. There is, after rehearsal 29, there is a line of Macduff's saying, drop the branches and pick up arms. And then a phrase of the chorus. That can be taceted. 100 years ago, it was probably acceptable to see choristers marching with branches and then doing this. But since the chorus already has told Macbeth, the previous page, that they've seen Birnam Wood moving towards them, and it'd be one thing if we had 50 choristers with branches, but usually in most productions that I've seen, you have maybe 8 or 10 people with branches and it looks a little silly. We can just eliminate that line and fill that music from 29 to 35 just with dueling and only have the line of Macbeth to Macduff, I mean rather Macduff to Macbeth and vice versa in their duel, so that you have dueling with chorus or supers, and then finally Macduff and Macbeth, with Macbeth's wounding and death. One other little thought. I transpose down by half a step the first bar only of the aria, Mal per me, in the orchestra first, because I do find the original key at this point a bit abrupt for today's audience. This is what you would hear with the transposition. Without that transposition of one measure, this is what you'd hear. And especially considering the time that this is still second period Verdi, it's a little, as I said, abrupt for me. The aria then is, you know, is mal per me che m'affidai nel presagi dell'inferno, and he dies. Okay, now, Madame Butterfly. Puccini wrote Butterfly finished it in 1904. It was produced at Scala and basically was a failure. He did an extensive rewrite, and it was redone about 5-6 months later in the city of Brescia, and it was a big success. But the version that we hear for the most part, 90%, 95% of the time, is the version of 1907 called the Paris version. It was the one that Puccini sanctioned after he did it, and it was the only version that Ricordi allowed until copyright ended. What is it? It is basically Brescia with about 10 minutes of music cut from it. And I agree that it is very concise and works beautifully and is the preferable version to do. The one little exception, I would say, is a very brief minute, less than a minute of music in Act Two, when Suzuki is making Butterfly up. It shows Butterfly's desperation and her fear and pain that maybe, even though Pinkerton has come back, he will not love her. In an earlier video, I talked about expressive leaps and how this was something that happened in the late Romantic and early contemporary time period. And usually it's to show great expressivity. In this case, we have a leap that shows fear, almost pain. And it's this. Fammi bella, fammi bella, fammi bella. That phrase there. Now, it is to some extent blunted by the orchestra. The harmonies make that dissonant leap less obvious and less painful, but that leap is there. And this is how it fits in. I'm starting at rehearsal 83 and how that little section fits in to the music. Troppi sospiri la bocca mandò e l'occhio riguardò nel lontan troppo fiso. New music. Suzuki, fammi bella, fammi bella. Gioia
a riposo accrescono beltà. Chissà, 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 chissà. Dammi sul, and this is the music we hear. Dammi sul viso un tocco di carmino. Okay, so that little bridge has that wonderful dissonant leap, and I think adds a little important nuance to Butterfly's character. Thank you very much, and until next time.